Okay, we're going to talk about Datadog, a company that just went public this week. We kind of had to get up to speed quickly on this one because shares just hit the public markets this week, Joey.
Yeah, Datadog, it's a monitoring and analytics platform. So what they're doing is they give you kind of a real-time insight into your company's entire technology stack. So you could be looking at all your different servers, applications, all your different cloud-based softwares, and you're seeing it in one spot. So it's almost like giving you a bird's eye view of your entire organization. So you know if something's going wrong, where it's at, it allows you to search it. And it's basically that key player in digital transformation and cloud migration, which it feels like every software company we talk about does the same thing, where it's focused on, yeah, the digital transformation and making it better for customers or businesses finding your service. But Datadog, they've kind of made it easier and put it all on one platform.
Yeah, I think that even as someone who follows this space, I know you and I have both talked about this before, it can be tough to really separate what a lot of these SaaS companies do. And I know that you have some tricks for kind of getting to the root of, okay, who's truly the best-in-class provider here? There are some company metrics that you can help do that with, but I know that you like to ask around the fool for some of the subject matter experts that work in spaces, and you have a couple other tricks for also kind of getting to the bottom of this stuff with online forums and things like that.
Yeah, so how I'll originally go through an S1 is I'll completely ignore what a company does. Like I might know, okay, it's a tech company, and I'll look at the numbers first. And when I see over 80% revenue growth and net dollar retention over 140%, a growing customer base, everything about Datadog from the financial standpoint, I loved. So then I back into, okay, now let's find out what these guys do and what kind of competitors there are. So then seeing, okay, with the rise of data, and I think it's going to be a fivefold increase in the amount of data companies have to be analyzing over the next 10 years, finding companies that can make sense of it, monitor it, and make the digital process easier is key. So then I go to, you know, tech companies, or I go to tech players here at The Fool, and of course we use Datadog. Then I'll check sites like G2 Crowd or Gartner Insights, and I'll see what these other developers or people that actually use software say about these companies. And then I just see, I think it was like 4.5 stars, and I'm seeing all these as good as it gets ratings in comparison to their key competitors. So then I'll look at the competitors, and yeah, it checks out. The reviews aren't as good. And they're basically saying, because Datadog's this unified platform where all the other major players integrate within, it creates that all-in-one solution, which is another keyword I always like to look for, all-in-one solution. Like, okay, they do what other people do, but they combine it all to where there might be a competitor for a specific division, but not the entire company.
Yeah, it's great to be a full-service provider. It's a pretty excellent space to be in. Listeners, tell us if you've heard this one before. They're a SaaS company, they've got great margins, and they're losing money because they're investing heavily in SG&A. Is that pretty much the easiest way to sum them up on the financials, Joey?
Yep, pretty much. But I will say, now, this wasn't confirmed by management or anything, but I have seen that they do have previous years where they did reach profitability. So I found a couple different blog posts where it's like insiders, but they wouldn't confirm because they weren't supposed to be saying it. But it's like, yeah, 3 of the last 7 years, they were profitable. And you look at the margins and they're not burning a lot of cash, they're not losing a lot of money. It almost seems like they ramped up spend going into this IPO to boost those growth rates, which makes sense. But even then, you look, their net dollar retention over the last 12 months was 146%. In 2017, it was 141%. In 2018, 151%. So those are those statistics where I fell in love going through the financials, and it's like, I don't care what this company does, I'm going to find out a way to love it.
I think at some point we may have to build a small shrine to the dollar net retention figure in the studio so that we can occasionally bow to it.
Over 140%. I mean, it's almost unheard of these days. There's only a few companies. I remember this one, and I think Twilio, and I think PagerDuty was up there too. So yeah, those three companies lately have got my attention. But yeah, definitely a great statistic.
Yeah, it's the kind of thing you almost have to do a double take on. And it's proof. You know, you go to the forums and you read that, okay, this seems to be a best-in-class provider. Well, that's borne out in the metrics as well, right? You don't get a number like that unless you are proving your value to customers and they're increasing their spend with you.
Exactly. And I was going through the timeline of the company. It started as, you know, this base platform that did one thing, and then they added another solution, and they've added three new solutions in the last 3 years. So you see, people trust the brand. They know that they're very good at what they do. So then they're like, hey, we added this to our platform, which is an easy bolt-on. We think you want it too. So it's great to see. And that could be the primary reason why we have these three great net dollar retention rates, and that could be exactly why they waited to go public, so they could say, hey, you know, maybe 2016 was 120% or something like that. It couldn't have been as great, but they knew, hey, if we ramp up spend, go public in 2019, we're going to have some great statistics to show for it.